And now let's try to finish this chapter, The Cottage on the Moor, from The Sleepers, from The Great King by Susan Cooper. Not too much of it left. We've had Bran's confrontation with his father, and now we are picking up with Will again, who is riding with the harp back to the cottage. Will rode more slowly than he had expected. The awkward shape of the harp pressed against his chest cut into his bruised arm and hurt so much that soon he could scarcely keep from dropping it. He stopped often to change its position. There were other reasons for pausing, too, for the ferocity of malevolence building up in the valley now thrust at him like a great hand, pushing him away, threatening to clutch him in the giant fingers and crush him into nothingness. Doggedly, Will rode on. First the cottage, then the lake, in the discordant chaos, trying to force him back. Only the simplest thoughts and images could survive, keep their shape. First the cottage, then the lake, he found himself saying under his breath. Those were the two tasks for the harp that, above all else, he must make sure were carried out in these next two or three hours. The enchanted music must release Penn from the grip of the werestone in the cottage so that he would escape Caradog Pritchard's gun. That was a simple matter. But then, more important than anything in the world, the music must wake the sleepers of the Pleasant Lake, the creatures who slept their timeless sleep beside Talia Lynn, whoever or whatever those creatures might be. For if a lord of the dark, such as the Grey King, could gain so astonishing a power as was now filling this valley after centuries of murmuring sleep beneath his mountain, then indeed the dark was rising, and its whole power increasing like a vast cloud threatening to engulf the whole world. At last he came to the cottage, and found it empty. Will stood in the bare stone-walled room, baffled and anxious. How could Penn have escaped the power of the werestone? Where was Bran? Had Caradog Pritchard come hunting with aid from the Grey King and carried them both off? Impossible. Caradog Pritchard was an unwitting servant, knowing nothing of his own links with the Grey King. He was a man only, with the instincts of a man. The worst instincts, with the best sadly submerged. Where was Bran? He crossed to the corner of the room. The small white pebble that was the werestone lay just as it had lain before, innocuous and deadly. All around him the force of the Grey King's will beat implacably. Go away! Give up. You will not win. Give up. Go away. Will cast desperately about through the powers of his own mind to find out what might have happened to Bran and the dog, but found nothing. He thought miserably, you should never have left them here alone. In a kind of angry self-abasement, he leaned down once more and put his hand to the small round stone that he knew would be bound fast to the earth. Beyond any ability of his to move it a fraction of an inch, the werestone came away as easily as any other stone, and lay loose in his palm as if asking to be used. Will stared at it. He could not believe what he saw. What had loosed the grip of the werestone? No magic, he knew, could do such a thing. It was part of the law that the light could not budge a werestone of the dark, nor the dark influence a werestone of the light. That monstrous rigidity, once in force, could not be shattered by any but the stone's owner, who then could have broken the power of the werestone of the Brennan Lude, other than the Brennan Lude himself, the Grey King. Will shook his head impatiently. He was wasting time. One thing was certain at any rate. Left now without ownership, its control broken, the werestone was outside the law, and could itself be employed to tell him what had happened, to bring it to its strange present state. Will kept close hold of the harp. He felt he would never put it down again, least of all in this place, but he stood in the center of the room with the werestone lying in his open palm, and he said certain words in the old speech and emptied his mind and waited to receive whatever kind of awareness the stone could put into it. The knowledge would not be simple and open, he knew. It never was. It came as he stood there with his eyes closed and his mind thrumming in a series of images so rapid that they were like a narrative, a piece of a story. Will saw a man's face, strong and handsome, but worn, with clear blue eyes and a gray beard. Though the clothes were strange and rich, he knew who it was in an instant. The face was that of the second lord in the cavern of Bird Rock, the lord in the sea-blue robe, who had spoken with such particular and then unaccountable closeness to Bran. There was a deep sadness in the man's eyes. Will saw then the face of a woman, black-haired and blue-eyed, twisted in a dreadful mingling of grief and guilt, and somewhere with them he saw Merriman. Then he was seeing a different place, a low building with heavy stone walls, and a cross above its roof, a church or an abbey, and from it Merriman was leading the same woman with a baby in her arms. They stood in a high place, on one of the old ways. There was a great whirling of mist, a rushing and a flurry of images so fast that Will could not follow, nor make out more than a flash of the cottage and an upright, smiling Owen Davies with a younger, unlined face, and dogs and sheep and the mountain slopes, with bracken and a voice calling, "Gwenny! Gwenny!" Then, clearer than any, he saw Merriman, hooded in the dark blue robe, standing with the black-haired woman up on the slope above the Dicenny Valley on Cadfan's Way. She was weeping quietly, tears running slow and glinting down her cheeks. She held nothing in her arms now. Merriman stretched out his hand, fingers stiff straight, and Will heard through the whistle of the wind a thread of bell-like music that, as an old one, following the ways of the old ones, he had heard before in other places and times. Then the whirling came again, and all was confusion, though now he knew from the music that what he was witnessing was a traveling back to another age, long ago, the movement through time that held no difficulty for an old one or a lord of the dark, though impossible for men except in dreams. In a last flashing image he saw the woman who had been with Merriman turn and go sadly back into the stone-built abbey and disappear behind its heavy walls and away alone elsewhere, yet superimposed on the abbey like the reflection in the glass that covers a picture. He saw the bearded face of a lord who had worn the sea-blue robe, of the lord who had worn the sea-blue robe with the gold circlet of a king crowning his head. And suddenly Will understood the true nature of Bran Davies, the child brought out of the past to grow up in the future, and he felt a terrible compassion for his friend, born to a fearsome destiny of which as yet he could have no clear idea at all. It was hard even to think about so astounding a depth of power and responsibility. He saw now that he, Will Stanton, last of the old ones, had been fated all along to aid and support Bran in time to come, just as Merriman had always been at the side of Bran's great father, the father who had not known of his son's existence back when he had been born, and who, only now over the centuries, had as a high lord of magic seen him for the first time. It was clear enough now how the ownership of the Werestone had been broken. Beside a figure of this rank, the power of the Grey King dwindled to insignificance. But that was true only if Bran truly knew what he was doing, how much of his buried and infinitely powerful nature had really been released. How much had he seen in the cottage? What images had spun into his own unsuspecting mind? Clutching the harp, forgetting his arm hurt in his haste, Will ran out of the cottage, clambered on the bicycle, and made off along the road to Talia Lynn. Bran could have gone nowhere else. All roads now must lead to the lake and to the sleepers, for at stake was not only the quest of the golden harp, the sleepers waking, but a power of the high magic that could, if still unrecognized and uncontrolled, destroy not only that quest, but the light as well. And that is the end of the chapter called Cottage on the Moor.